If there was ever a perfect match, it's Lorrie Goulet and the Art Students League. She is someone who has devoted herself to a tradition of making art, in this case carving, that goes back to the history of civilization itself. And that devotion has only grown throughout the years, and you find out that when you are someone who is committed to art and you find the right place to make that art, you just continue to learn and be a student as much as you are a master. When it comes to teaching, Lorrie has not only instilled an education of for people who, you know, about their technique, about how to carve, how to make art, but also instilled a deep respect for the tradition of making art, especially carving, that is so important to understand, because when you're a student and you start to not just learn how to do things, but also understand that you're part of a tradition that goes back literally thousands of years, it's an even deeper inspiration. So Lorrie's teaching has been very much involved with that, and I'm sure many of her students, some of whom are here today, have really appreciated what she has given them, not just in terms of technique, but in terms of a certain respect of history. And that's a very important part of learning, and it's especially important here at the League. So now that I've said that, let me introduce Lorrie Goulet to talk about her work and her book. Thank you.
Hello, am I speaking too loud for you? No, okay. Thank you, Ira. In fact, I want to thank the Art Students League for inviting me here today to celebrate this bookwarming, due to the fact that I spent 23 years teaching here at this wonderful institution and enjoyed every day of it, and I loved my students that came from many, many different parts of the world. We had wonderful, wonderful classes. Since I've retired, I'm still working and keeping up the activity to bring good health to myself and keep filling the world with stone sculptures. As you know, I wanted to tell you a little bit about the book. I never in a million years thought I was going to make a book last year, or any year. And then my granddaughter, Emma, where is Emma, brought back a fellow from Dublin whom she married, who happened to be a great technician and very talented in all the everything to do with high tech. And he took my group of 198 photographs, and he made a book out of it and published it, and this is the book. And I'm very pleased with the book. He also retouched most of the photographs because they were not of the highest quality, but the book quality is excellent, and that's because Paul Staunton did the work. I also wanted to tell you about the poetry book here. What was actually the first book from last year, a tryout book that we wanted to sample how this electronic publishing went. And it turned out very well, and this is why we went ahead with the book. I'd like to tell you a little bit about the work to be sure that you understand what direct carving is, and this kind of work that I've spent all my life doing. The principle behind direct carving is that we do not use models or maquettes. We don't copy anything. It's a creative process from day one, from when we begin with a raw stone. We start to think about the stone and great respect for the stone, and we develop forms, and we take forms into shapes, into we call it blocking. We block the shapes, and then it progresses into a becoming a sculpture through various stages. I really never know what I'm going to turn out with. I start with a blank page, and it fills up with some things, and finally it becomes clear. When the piece is very well advanced, I know what I have, and I know where I'm going, and I finish. And I used to say, I don't know where I'm going, but I know when I get there, which I finally do know with my sculpture. And it's a most exciting, beautiful craft, which I've taught my students that who learned to carve the very first day and usually loved it, as I love carving. Not that many of them would stick to it because it's a very hard profession. But I still have hope that someplace, I had so many foreign students that out there, they are pursuing their work, and maybe one or two of them will become first-class artists. I know I had some really remarkable students, hundreds of different over the years. That was 23 years, a lot of students passed through. And I also wanted to say one other thing. The very reason that I'm here is because of Jose de Kreft, whom I was married to, and he was a teacher before them, and he also was my teacher, and he set the example for the way I work and the attitude that I have toward carving, which I, of course, try to pass on to the students. My book does not have any text, if you notice that. The only thing, it has a few of these, I call them, they're actually poems, or we call them meditations, that express some of my feelings about my sculpture and the art. All right, I'm going to, let me read you some of my poems that are in this book. I think I have to tell you that one remark that I made last time at the last bookwarming about how you make elephants in stone. Do any of you remember that? How do you carve an elephant in stone? You take away everything that doesn't resemble an elephant. And also, that's how you make a work of art in stone. Take away everything that doesn't resemble a work of art. It's what we do. I think that's a very good example, because exactly what we do, we take away to discover something. The poem I'm going to read you this time is, it's called A Carver's Poem. To remove by uncovering layer by layer, shiny, in a search to find what lies within the block, to find myself by force of hand and tool, culling by measure the solid rock, to carve the valleys and the hills, excavating form, sometimes drawing powder, rasp and files draw little else. The time is a fire burning, these few hours passed in struggle with the image and the stone. Outside of now, there is no other time. The hammer falls on steel. I listen to the sound of the cracking blow and marble ringing. Through the window, the breeze carries off the dust. The masses are enlarging by meticulous subtraction. Particles and fragments on the floor. Chips of choice and rejection. in the quiet of the studio, alone, in a temple with a stone, my sculpture grows. Each day, the ritual of the flying chips in my meditation and motion, and the solid rock before me waiting to become transfixed with radiance and presence. My hand holds and turns the stone, pounding mallet to steel tip to release the image. What is one looking for, digging in with this pointed spade into the immaculate stone, millennials of eons old? To know when one has found it, this is the prize, the gift. And working with water and stone on stone, rubbing with force and patience to wash away a cloudy surface, to see the crystal shine, the marble glowing, burnished to a polish by backbone and sweat and enduring discipline. This is the work of shaping spirit into form, to find emotion, my own, myself, hidden in the block. This is the act of carving, to free the image in the stone, a mirror reflecting itself, infinite as echo. This is the meaning, the presence, hewn with love, that others see and touch. This is shining, I'm trying to get, yeah. Okay. This one is called The Song of Sculpture. Lost ancient sculptures in broken temples found, a residue of old glories, of what man has done or wished to do. It is a song rising from the ruins, echoed in the crumbling, echoed in the crumbling temple, rising from the ruins, echoed in the crumbling temples that man and time, each vandal in his own way, has made. It is a melody of art and form, archived in stone, of man's quest for beauty and the yearnings of his soul, of how he sought heaven and sometimes found it. He often made a hell and lived it. All this engraved in stone. Yet did he always search for permanence and grace, as he ever praised and damned his gods. With his tools and stones. It is the song of the artist, the music of history come to life in the fallen ruins. The stela, the icon, the Buddhas, in templed silence. These are the fragments that chant for him and bear the fruit of his having been. These are the sculpture of man who destroys in order to create, of man who still does as he listens to the chronicle of songs, to continue as he always will, to etch his history in the earth hard rock as he must, to carve his soul in stone, to seek his paradise. Well, I have one more. I do have another one that's rather long, but I think I'll just close with the smaller one. It's called Anima in Stone. If we have a sorrow of our own, do I follow mine or does it follow me? Or are we one, love not of mayhem? What force burning through my hands in motion felt as purpose, sending itself into the silent stone? What from the far distant space comes through my fingertips that sets a cornucopic flow, electric, into the living stone? That's all. I hope you enjoyed listening to those. And does anyone have a question that they wanted to know anything about? No? What, dear? I can't hear you very well.
Tell us about
Would you please tell me what she said?
Tell us the piece that you are working
on. Oh, yes. Yes. I'm working on a alabaster. It has many colors in it, white with many colors. It's about 3 feet, about 200 pounds, and it's of a woman on her back who's being wafted on the waves, the ocean, bubbling ocean, and she's being held up in lying back, suspended. And that's the way it's going to be. It's going to be a very light, weightless sculpture. And I'm about in the middle of it, and I'm doing the finishing touches of it. I have the composition complete. And the next phase will be the polishing, finishing. We start with the blocking, and then we have the development and, you know, the certain stages, certain tools, and various kinds of work that go into that. And it's a lot of fun. By the way, sculpture is fun. It's a beautiful craft, and it's also very mind-consuming. It's very fulfilling when it's finished. And I would say I've spent my whole life working on something that I love, and that gives me great happiness and great contentment and satisfaction. So I feel I've spent all these 67 or 70 years doing something purposeful. Yeah?
Lorrie, with all the experience you've had, 60 years you're talking about, are there any expectations that you have when you encounter a stone or a piece of wood that you're trying to pursue even further
What was that in essence? I can't hear, you know, I'm very deaf. That's why what did he say?
I was asking about your expectations when you begin a piece.
Oh, yeah.
Is that just...
Do I have any?
Do you have any?
You know, I forgot to tell you, Ira, I never expect anything. I never know what I'm going to do. I don't know what I'm doing until I really get into the piece, and I have no guarantee what's going to happen. But it always something, I work it out. It becomes a piece. I do not know what I'm going to work, what's going to happen, because I don't have a maquette. And that's the beauty of it, that it's very creative, because when you have things that happen in the stone or different things, you come up with creative solutions. That's what makes it so fun. That's right. There's no way to have big expectations now. This is not the time for that. But as I say, as I go on day by day, I'm still enjoying doing my work.
And maybe that's in and of itself the greatest.
You never know. Never know what'll happen.
Yeah.
Yes, Mary? You know, I want to talk to you about the stones. During my life, I've worked on hundreds of different kind of stones, from the hardest, like granite and onyx and stalagmite and all kinds of beautiful hard stones. And then a beautiful colored stone, multi-stone Carrara, which is the most beautiful of all. And then we have limestone and... what I'm working now is the easier stone is the alabaster. I can't say what is my favorite. And when it comes to wood, my God, I could tell you my favorite would be the hardwoods from South America and Africa. ebonies, teak, rosewood, snakewood. But unfortunately, the manufacturers of furniture managed to get a ban on selling logs to artists. They feel that we are impinging on their business because they want all that hardwood for veneer. And that's why I cannot buy a log. I mean, this one artist in New York who works in hardwoods is impinging on their business. But they have the upper hand, and there's no way we're going to get any good wood. So I have some friends in California that have been sending me wood that they get from Hawaii, because there's no wood available in this, no hardwood, no beautiful woods. But I must say I had a good spell of working with these fantastic woods, and now I'm working on pines and ordinary woods. That's the way life goes. I don't think we're going to have any... buying stones is also difficult now. There aren't that many sculptors who are carving. The sculptors today are doing something else besides carving, which I hope that that doesn't last forever, because what will happen is that this whole technique will be lost. There will be no teachers teaching it, and no one will know how to do it, especially to carve wood. Wood is going fast because of a lack of obtaining wood to work on. Then who is going to teach? There'll be no teachers. There's only a few now, and like Gary, he's one of the few people who teaches wood and stone direct carving. It's a rare thing. And the students, I don't know what's going to happen with them. I have a feeling it's all going to be sort of died down for a while until maybe someday there'll be a resurrection. Don't you think that's pretty bad, Ira?
Well, as long as we're here,
the art students, as a matter of fact, this is the only place in this country that is teaching this in the proper way.
And that will be continued.
Yes, I'm very proud of being part of the league because of that reason. It's been very, you talked about tradition. Well, it's the flow of history, and the tradition goes on. It's not a question of being modern or old. It's a question that the movement of history is from here to here. We're part of it, and you will be part of it.
We are links in the chain. And as long as artists recognize that we are linked to our past as well as
absolutely
our future, we will continue in the same vein that you're talking about.
And that's the beauty of art. Yes. Anybody else have a question?
I have a question, actually.
Yes, John.
So, Lorrie, you've done lots of wood. You've been just talking about the wood you've done. You've done lots of different kinds of stone. Can you just talk a little bit about the difference between standing and starting a piece of stone and standing and starting a piece of wood? How different is it? Or is it?
What do you mean, the working of it?
The working of it.
Oh, well, there is... they're absolutely miles apart. They're two different worlds. There's this wood carving and stone carving. And the fact that I can do both they are totally, totally different kinds of things. And you can't say I like one and I don't like the other. Like what is your favorite child, You can't do that. Wood is beautiful because it's beautiful, for the trees are so beautiful, and the colors and the textures. And it carves a different way. It doesn't make as noise like the stone. It has its own kind of beautiful beauty. Wood. Stone is noisy, is dusty, is dirty, it's all over the floor, but it is beautiful. And you communicate with your stone. The stone gives you something. The stone has radiations. The stone is alive, as both the wood, but the stone really connects with you. And when you work stone, you feel something you can't explain. Many things in art cannot be explained. but you feel them nevertheless. And if you had me to choose what I want, I said, no, I cannot choose. If I lived only in an apartment, I would probably have to choose whittling, you know, with a penknife on wood. But if I have a studio, it would be both carving stone and carving wood. And the way I do it is in the wintertime, when I can't get as much air, I try to do wood carving. And when the spring and summer and fall comes, when I have more circulation, I try to do stone. And may I say something about Charlie, my son-in-law? Charlie has been moving my stones for the past 30 years. Put it here, Charlie, put it there. Bring it over here, upstairs. He has been handling and moving my stones and setting up my exhibition and going with me sometimes to pick out the stones. Right, Charlie?
That's
and he knows a lot about stones. And I just wanted to recognize what a great help he's been to me, the stones. What?
Well, I kind of wanted to ask another question. Is it okay? Do you have this is really putting you on the spot. I won't ask you what your favorite stone creation is, your favorite stone piece. But I will ask you, is there one piece when you think about the work you've done, is there one piece that always comes to mind? Is there one piece that you...
It's an odd piece. It's the one, I worked on a stalagmite. It was rather a big one. It's about like this. It was heavy. And it was beautiful. It was a reddish gold. And when I made a figure out of it, it was very, very difficult to work. The stalagmite, you know, from the caves. Mm-hmm. And when I polished it, you could see into it. You could see down into the, like water. It was most extraordinary to see a stone. My God, you could see into it. Maybe about that much. The light would go in. I said, that I never forgot that stone. And it was very hard. And somebody bought it. It's gone. I don't know where it is right now. But that was my most, I would say, most unforgettable stone. Mm-hmm. Maybe it wasn't my most unforgettable sculpture, but it was the stone that I'll never forget. Mm-hmm. And the other stone was a lapis lazuli. I don't know if you know, there's the store on 34th Street that, you know, that wonderful store that sells all the gems, mm-hmm. gemstones. And okay. Was it 34th?
Around there,
yes. Yeah. I happened to pass by one day and I saw this in the window, a big piece of lapis lazuli, and I was taken by it. I said, I have to have that piece. And I go in and I buy it. I didn't even have the money for it. I said, I have to have that piece. So I took it home, and it was one piece was separate. I got a small piece and a large piece, and I carved it. It's a semi-precious stone, you know. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I carved it. I made a figure of it, and I exhibited it, and I sold it. But I did get a cast of it that I cast it in silver. The cast. And the other piece was a little small thing like that, a beautiful rich color. I made a figure and I sold that too. And the only thing I have now is I don't really have good photographs of it. I have the silver figures from that. Mm-hmm. Unforgettable stones. Absolutely, yes.
Is there a sense as an artist that when you're working, you're actually connecting with the history of the material as well as the intention of what you're trying to do?
Yes, definitely. I feel that connection terrific, and especially as I mature, is what we call this. I see back further. And I used to teach the student a very rare technique called rubbing. With abrasion, you use abrasion to make the forms, very much as the Egyptians used to use it for those beautiful forms, stones, all kinds of stone, which they don't teach that anymore. But when I used to abrase, I felt contact with 6,000, 7,000, 10,000 years ago, the same fellow who did that. And I have the theory that the Egyptians did not suffer as slaves carving all those stones, because stone carving is so charming and so seductive and so addictive, they were probably enjoying it all the time, even working out in the hot sun. Yes, I hope the history someday will find out that they really did love their work. Yes?
Do you ever use our tools? And
what does he think?
Do you ever use power tools?
Power tools. I have a compressor. I have power tools for wood and stone. I have used them. As a matter of fact, all it is, my compressor is a fast hammer. It goes very, very fast. It's actually too fast. It's so fast that you've got all the holding this like jackhammer in the street. What am I going to do? I can't. And you carve more than you want. You make mistakes. I've never used it very much except on the raw outside stone when I wanted to get rid of bumps or a lot of material at once and I wouldn't care how neat it was done, how careful. But I could never use that machine's the compressor on the finished piece. I've used grinders, but not, again, grinders are too much, they're too fast. They make marks on your start, they ruin your work. And if they teach the students to use a machine before they know how to carve, it's a great disaster what the student produces. It's ridiculous. You cannot make a machine. It's just a machine. It's not a thinking. Well, they're going to make thinking machines pretty soon. Thinkies.
Did you always finish your pieces by hand?
Always. That reminds me, I always work, let's say, half the pieces by hand toward the end. A student once said to me, "Miss Goulet, how do you manage to make your pieces look like they're done by hand?" How do you like that? That's a strange question. How do I manage to make it look like I'm done?
Did the last part of your question, did that kind of relate? How does that using a machine for any part of it relate to the work? Did that?
I think so.
Yeah. We used machines for grinding. They help sometimes in difficult pieces, but I like to do it by hand. In fact, now I'm not using any machines because I haven't got the same. What do they call it? I'm not as sharp as I used to be, that I don't want to have accidents with machines, so I'm doing it all by hand. And I just love it. Why? Who brought the machines in anyway? I'm getting the same results by hand. Yes?
Another question, maybe it relates. Have you ever had physical problems from carving?
Have you ever had physical problems from carving?
No. No. What does he mean? Lung troubles or anything like that?
Well, like joint pain.
No, not yet. That's something I look forward to.
Huh?
What is that?
Has carving been physically preservative to
form? Oh, yes. Absolutely. The reason I'm in good health is because I've been doing this daily for the last 65 years. You know, I didn't just do it as a hobby or three times a week. Every single time that I could, Saturdays and Sundays. So I just kept working. And finally the doctor said, well, you're healthy because you've been doing that weightlifting all these years. That's the best thing for your lungs, for everything. And I'm a smoker, and I had the stone dust, and my lungs are clear, and my heart is clear, and my blood pressure is perfect. So what else could be? It's got to be the sculpture. It has to be this, and also the happiness that I have from working with that sculpture. It is fun. It's a lot of fun. You know, years ago, I was doing some television with kids on a Sunday morning program, and I liked the television as a medium. And I said, gee, I want to make a program. I'm going to call it The Joy of Carving. That was the name of it. And the producer said, yes, she'd like to do it. It turned out I would have to spend the whole week, all week, every day, in order to make it look like this was a spontaneous eruption, my program. No, I would never make my own sculpture. And I said, no way. I'm sorry. Let someone else make the Joy of Sculpture program. But if someone did, it would have a tremendous audience. You know, the cooking classes, well, the joy of carving is much bigger than the joy of cooking. Because you eat it and forget it, but you've got the carving there forever. And you see it, and you touch it. I wanted to say something about touching sculpture. Many of my people have heard me say that it is a visual and tactile art. That if you can see it, you can touch it, you can walk around it, you can carry it. But what else you can do is you can pet it, and you rub it. This is, ask Julie, she has a piece, she says she's always rubbing it. It's part of the pleasure. It's so tactile, and that's what, you can't touch a painting. Just see, when is the time you touched a painting and you enjoyed it or something? No, you can't touch a painting. So there you've got a sculpture, and you could touch it, and you can hug it.
This is kind of funny, given that that Lorrie had right at the entrance to the house for years and years, this bust, this beautiful marble of a woman's, very voluptuous woman. Go touch it, you know, since you come in. Yeah.
As a matter of fact, your boy, my grandson, used to walk by there every morning, and he just did it like that as he went to school. I told him about that, he remembers. That's the way it is, why not?
Why not?
It's beautiful. It's only stone. And that particular piece, by the way, I had a man who fell in love with it. And he said, I'm going to bring my wife to see it, and we're going to take it home. He brought his wife to see the piece. She took one look at it, and she said, I will not live in the same house with that piece. That was the end of the deal. Oh, God, you know you have some very interesting experiences.
I have a question.
Yeah.
You're a carver, and yet you're writing poetry.
Oh, I've always been writing poetry. In fact, I wrote poetry before I was carving, and I was a painter before I was a sculptor. That's just another part of my life that has been buried all these years. And my poetry has been buried all these years. This book was 50 years ago. I put it on the shelf. I never saw it, touch it again. Paul brought it out because he made a book of it. And the poetry, this thing, these are very old. I did these 30 years ago.
What are the writers that you like to read while you were carving? Do you read books? Do you read literature, poetry? What other poets?
What literature do you read, particularly with respect to your, when you're working on a piece, do you read any poetry? Do you read?
No.
Do you?
No.
No. You read the news, I know that.
Huh?
You read the news.
I used to read the news.
Ah, okay.
I just haven't got time to read the news, and it's too depressing. I don't like to be depressed. I like to be up, happy. I listen to music, and when I work, I listen to music, particularly classic music, particularly Johann Sebastian Bach. That's my musician of choice.
Any audiobooks, audio, nothing? Audio poetry, history?
No poetry, no nothing, no audiobooks?
No. You know, this is the only, this is just now I've been coming, I'm coming out of the closet of poetry.
And
this is only the second time in my life that I read my poetry to an audience. Would you like to know? February 1st was the last book thing, and here, this is the second time I've read to you. After all these years. Thank you.
Wow.
Well, there was no one that encouraged me or knew about it. It just takes a long time to get to. Well, I'm a closet painter also. I have never had an exhibition of my painting. I've been painting all these times that I've been sculpting. The reason I can't get a painting show, but I have two galleries, two very good galleries, he said, the people will look at your paintings and they won't buy the sculpture. It's their bottom line that they're worried about, not about whether I do art or their artist is a painter. They're not afraid I will kill a sale. Well, anyway, that's the reality of these dealers with artists. I don't even know if I will leave this world if I will have an exhibition of my paintings. I'm going to try to do it before that time comes. But, you know, you see me working very hard to prepare the paintings, put them in order, all kinds of things. Mm-hmm. What can you do with destiny?
Accept it.
Yeah. So that's what I'm going to accept my destiny unless something special happens, which it may happen, something special. Mary? Why don't I what?
Mary says, why not improve it?
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's the way to go, improve it.
Looking back on your wonderfully off life, are there certain decisions that you made, certain wisdoms you would share with others if you look back?
Looking back, are there certain decisions you've made that you would things that you would do differently.
You would like to share.
Oh, I'm sorry, decisions that you, things that you've
wisdom,
done. Things that you've
you
done that you, decisions you've made and actions you've taken that you, that were important to you and that you would like to share.
Oh, yes. She's asking me.
She's asking you a very personal question.
Oh, yes. Oh, of course. I don't know where to... That's a big question, Mary.
Mary says you can give a short, condensed version.
Oh, God.
I think you stumped her.
You know, most of the decisions that I've made in my life were not kind of decisions. They were sort of the way life took me that way. You know, understand? All I did was sort of get in step with the way my life turned out. And I did decide when I was very, very young that I wanted to be a sculptor. And I wanted to be a stone carver. And I remember when I told my mother, my family, she said, girls don't make sculpture. That was the end of it. And I said to myself, I don't know about other girls, but this girl's going to make sculpture one day. And I did. I've stuck to it. That was the decision I made, and I'm glad I stuck with it. And usually, these important decisions, it's a question of, can you do it? Can you maintain that? Do you have the guts or the strength to pursue that? And I did. I said, yes, I will do it. I will pursue it. As I said, now I will carve until I can't carve. there's no question of deciding. The question, just go with it. Go with it, the way life has. And if I was born in a situation that the girls don't do sculpture, no. You have to do by your own will and say, I will, I will, I will. You know, that's like a communist. No, it's not political. This is from the soul. This is the heart. And that's what I wanted to say, that people used to ask me, where do you get your ideas? Where is your inspiration? And my ideas come because, first of all, I learned to draw, which was my big passion in youth, was to learn to draw. And I'm drawing constantly, and I have constantly the figures in all positions. I've never come at a loss for a composition. And if I had another 25 years to go, you would see me produce a great deal more of new sculpture that I've never done before. As a matter of fact, the sculpture I'm doing now is new. It's not like my other pieces. It's a step forward. It's a not a breakthrough, but it's the continuation. When you go like this, you continue this way. Not usually that. That is not typical of an artist who spent their life struggling. The struggle is up. Well, I hope they keep going up. You have to be very positive, very positive. I think of sculpture as stone, as a positive material. I don't know if that answered it. You. There's so many things that one can say about sculpture, and especially when you had a whole life, a long life of it. I love to see children. You know, when children come into my studio, they're like little angels, and because they're so, they go out and they touch the sculpture. I don't tell them to. They touch and they feel the sculpture, and they don't know how to speak about the sculpture, but they understand the sculpture in their heart because they're so pure. And when they get older, they have to feel that they have to explain themselves and everything. But the young children, they have a wonderful time. I had them visit me recently, and they were running around all looking at all the sculpture, and I said, which is the sculpture that you like the most? And they said, that one. That one was of a figure with birds. There were birds and a man with a bird all around him, doves. It was sort of a figure with a bird like a dove. And I said, that's the one that they like the best. Both of them, the boy and girl. And I think now, if I ever have the chance, but I don't think I will, I was wanted to have an art school to teach teenagers. I think the time you should start carving was when you're 13 or 14, the most, when you're still young, and maybe even 12. 12 would be a good time. Imagine how well that you'd be prepared, and you have your life, and you could zoom. Because the training for sculpture takes so long that it wears you out before you get started, but you stay with it because you're dedicated to it. But if you could start when you're young, like playing an instrument, you know, when you're young, you can much easier. That's what I would recommend for the future, that you all young people start early on carving, if they're ever going to be carvers in the future. And I hope that my friend Carol will be one of the teachers that will teach this. I have to tell you about Carol. She is a student that I am working with for 4 years now. I am intending to give Carol every single thing I know or about sculpture, as much as one person can transfer this information to another one. You know, I want her to have all that I can give her. So she's going to carry this on. Right, Carol? And she's doing pretty good at it. Okay, does anyone want to ask another question? Well, I want to thank you. You've been such a wonderful audience and so warm and receptive. It's been a real pleasure. It's been a real pleasure. What an audience.